So let's continue with our discussion of amenability. So we are talking about invariant means, another interesting difference between hard measure and invariant means is that there are actually lots and lots of invariant means. So maybe I can suggest one exercise to show that there are infinitely many invariant means on L infinity Z. So that's something which you can try to prove. So those means could be again constructed by an averaging process, as we have already seen in the first lecture, but one can play with this averaging process to see that you can have many different distinct means. So let's continue and try to prove this theorem. I'm only going to prove this direction because this is the only direction which we are going to use in the proof of Margulis theorem. As I said, it's really convenient to search for invariant means in the dual space of infinity. So those are all bounded linear functionals, it's also convenient to use the so-called Weak star topology. So Weak star simply means it's the topology such that the maps M goes to M of F, F in L1 G. I'm going to think about
you want things from L infinity of G to be the continuous functionals on the dual. So
yeah.
The way that you want.
Yeah, so the maps from
it was right, it's F in L infinity.
So f is fixed and it defines a functional on the dual, and you want this functional to be continuous.
No, but that would be weak topology, right?
It's a weak star. Alex, I think you're confused with the fact that L infinity is a dual by itself, which has nothing to do with this dual.
That would be the weak star, not the
one. The
weak topology would be to consider double star.
So this is the topology, right? And somehow, yeah. So the important thing is that there is a Banach Alaugus here. So that's what we are going to use. So now here I denote space M, subset M. So those are all bounded linear functionals which satisfy properties 1 and 2. So properties 1 and 2 right here. So in particular, this is a subset of the unit ball. And so so it's clear that the set is non-empty. bounded. So in particular, it is compact with respect to mixed-star topology. So this is one of and it's also convex. And there is a nature of a continuous action of a G on an M. And so so if you know that G is amenable, then we get that there exists G-fix point. Which so G-fix point exactly corresponds to an invariant mean. So, so it's really just an application of the fixed point theorem. Yeah, so, so that's actually easy direction of this theorem. So, so I'm not going to prove. I mean, it's not very difficult, but usually one needs to introduce notion of barycenter of measure to prove the opposite direction. So, okay, but yeah, it's very convenient to know that minability is related to existence of invariant mean. Okay, so 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 another characterization of minability would be in terms of existence of almost invariant vectors. So so it turns out that G amenable, this is equivalent to the following. So there exists a sequence of functions phi n in L2 of G with L2 norm of phi n 1 and with the property that for every G in G we compare translation of phi n with itself, then the L2 norm goes to zero as n goes to infinity. So so if g is infinite, then there is no invariant functions in L2 of g, but on the other hand, it could be that there are the sequences of vectors which are asymptotically invariant. And this property is exactly equivalent to amenability. So, okay, so let's try to prove this. So that's more interesting. And I'm going to prove this direction. Yeah, so the idea would be, so we already know if G is amenable, then there exists an invariant mean. So the so idea would be to start with M, which is invariant mean on G. And then, so how do we get this almost invariant function? So, so what we can do for if you have a function, say psi in L1 of G, this naturally defines a linear function now on L infinity. So we can define L sub psi on L infinity G. You see, so which go which maps F to well, just the sum. And so the idea would be to this gives an element of L infinity G star. And so the idea would be to approximate approximate the invariant mean by those linear functionals. And then the invariants of invariant mean would be inhabited by approximation and would give us something which is almost invariant. So, yeah, so how would we do that? So, well, so so say we have a partition sigma, a finite partition G1 dot 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 GS of the set G, of the group G. Then we can define a function psi as follows. So we pick some elements GI in the elements of partition and define psi sub sigma of G. This is going to be sum I from 1 to S and of characteristic function of GI and then characteristic function of small GI. Okay, so so it turns out that if so now if we consider the corresponding linear functional, this would be in some sense an approximation of the invariant mean. So what precisely do I claim? So so if sigma is a refinement of the partition say A G complement A complement of A and then if I look on this linear functional applied to characteristic function of A, then it would be exactly equal to to the mean of this characteristic function. Yeah, so that's really just follows from additivity of invariant mean. So we have this property. So now we can start with some partition and start refining it. And so if partition gets finer and finer, then this property would be held on more and more points. So so now we can consider. Yeah, so maybe first, let's say, we write, so because G is countable, so that's convenient here, we can write, we can enumerate all elements in G, and then we can consider a sequence of partitions sigma n, which are given by G1, dot, 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 Gn, and then here I put all the other elements. So now if I have such a partition, so what do I get? So okay, maybe I can continue. So now for simplicity, let's denote psi sigma n by psi sigma n. And so so what I claim that for every x and g in g. So if I take n sufficiently large, then I'm going to have that L of psi n of characteristic function of x, which is of course the same as psi n of x. So this would be the same as m of the same as invariant mean, and similarly So if I fix x and g and take n big enough, so partition would be sufficiently fine, then this so the values given by this linear functional would be the same as the value given by the invariant mean. But you know that mean is invariant. So in fact, here we do have equality. So what I get in the end is that psi n g inverse x is the same as psi n of x.
Did you say that the invariant mean must be zero on singletons?
Yeah, it has to be zero, but let's see. So what did I do?
Maybe you want the complement of x? Or no, but that's...
Alex, maybe there is no need to be so specific about the approximating sequence. I mean, just the fact that you have a mean and you can approximate it with guys from L1, by density argument.
Yeah, that's the basic idea, but somehow, there is some strange something strange which happens here. Okay, so yeah, so maybe it's better not to waste time, but basically just say okay. Yeah, so what I want to claim is that from yeah, from the fact that psi n approximates so L of psi n approximates the invariant mean, it follows that g times psi n converges to psi n point wise. Yeah, so sorry, there is something strange with this argument, so I have to think about it. But yeah, I think the conclusion is still okay. So so then we get that, and
with this psi n, with this sequence, exact sequence, somehow psi n, as you define it, is just zero on the initial n elements, and then. So it just pointwise converging to zero. Ah, it's n goes to infinity.
Yeah, it's n goes to infinity. Sorry. So I think I have to define. So I don't want to waste time now, but I have to define partition in a different way. So I think the way I define partition, something is doesn't make sense. But
so what you're basically saying, if you have a sequence where the L psi n go to the mean, then the G phi n minus phi n goes to zero.
Yeah.
And such a thing exists, it's just
as dangerous. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. So maybe, let me just make this claim, and so maybe I'll try to fix this next time, because I don't want to waste time during the lecture. But say we constructed this sequence in some way. So then what we get. It's also clear from this definition, it's clear that L1 norm of psi n is equal to 1. So now, if you look on G psi n minus psi n, L1 norm. So because there is a uniform bound on the norm, so this converges to zero as n goes to infinity. So this is just by dominated convergence. And so what we have constructed so far is a sequence of almost invariant vectors in L1 or G. Once you have that, it's also easy to get something in L2 of G. So we can take phi n to be to be square root of psi n. So then what happens if you look on G phi n minus phi n to norm square. So this would be a sum over x. we do this sum. So then one can also use elementary inequality that let's see, a minus b squared is bounded. So if a and b are non-negative, then it's bounded by a squared minus b squared. So I can take the square inside. Yeah, which is the same. So what I'm getting here is exactly the L1 norm of G psi m minus psi n. And we know this converges to zero. So indeed, now we have finally constructed a sequence of invariant vectors. Unit invariant vectors which are contained in L2. So this gives one direction of the theorem, and actually it's the only direction which we are going to use. So I'm not going to give the proof of the other direction. Yeah, so I'll come back to this point next time. So I'm sure the argument is correct, it just means to choose approximation sequence in a better way. So any questions about...
I have a question about instruction. Mm-hmm. When you consider L psi of sigma, in the definition of psi sigma, mm-hmm. you make a choice of elements. Does it affect... Does the L psi of sigma depend on this choice or not?
Let's see, what do you mean? So we have a function, right, a function in L1, and then I just take a sum. Right, so here it's sum over x in g.
Below. If you take psi sigma.
Ah, psi sigma, yes.
So you made the choice of gi inside the class.
Ah, yes, yeah, okay. I see what you mean.
L psi sigma.
Yeah, of course it would. It would depend on GIs. Yes. So in principle, so I'm going to fix some choices of GIs, and then define psi sigma for some choices of GIs. So we only need to use this property, and for this property, it doesn't really matter which GI you pick. So you just pick them in some way. So you fix the choice, but yeah, it doesn't matter which one. Okay, so any questions? So that was a short introduction to amenability, which would be sufficient for our purposes. So now I'm going to continue and talk a little bit about property key. So it's property T, or sometimes it's called Kajdan property T. So in some sense, it's antipodal. Not completely antipodal, but close to being antipodal to amenability. And the way it's defined is that so the group G has property T if if there exists a compact subset K inside G, and there exists epsilon positive, with the following property, such that for every unitary unitary representation pi from G to U of H. So, so have you seen unitary representations in Furman course?
Yes.
Okay, so, so here H is a Hilbert space and U is the group of unitary operators. So we consider any unitary representation, and let's assume that there is no without G fixed vectors. So so then the claim is that for every V in H with a norm of V equals to 1, supremum over G in K, pi G V minus V is at least epsilon. So this is so maybe one way to think about it, it's a quantitative way, quantitative refinement of the property that there are no fixed vectors. So one has to think what is the right way to define quantitative refinement of no fixed vector property, and that's really a proper way to say it. And yeah, so if you compare this property with the property that we obtained for amenable groups, it really looks very different, almost opposite to what we get. And in fact, so one can prove, now we can prove the following proposition. So say we have G, which is discrete, and suppose that G is amenable, and has property T, so then this implies that G is finite. Yeah, so that's really one of the ingredients in the proof of Margulis theorem. So now, at least the strategy which I mentioned in the first lecture should make sense. So once we show that gamma factor n is amenable and has property t, then we are done. Okay, so why is this? Well, so let's consider a regular representation, a so-called regular representation so G acting on L2 of G, so which is defined of course by saying that F is mapped to F plus X. So it's a nice unitary representation. And so so we know that G is amenable, so so by amenability, so we know that by amenability we know that there exists a sequence of vectors phi n in L2 of G with L2 norm 1. Which also has the property that rho g phi n, so this thing goes to zero. So that's for every g in g. So now if I pick a finite, so here k would be finite set, so So then I can also take maximum over G K. So here K is inside G prime. But on the other hand, but that's really something which contradicts this. Well, it almost contradicts this inequality. The only way to get around these two statements is to conclude that L2 of G must contain a G-fixed vector. So by property T, L2 of G contains a G fixed vector. So you have a G invariant function. So then you obtain that one is contained in L2 of G, which is only possible, right? Because you're looking at square summable function. So that's only possible if G is finite. So indeed we see that amenable groups and property T groups have very small intersection. So these two classes have very small intersection. Okay, so now I should give at least one example of amenable group and property T group, and this would be the group SLN R when n is at least 3. So before I start the proof, I need to introduce one very convenient tool. So here is the basic question. So say we have u sub t, this would be one parameter group of unitary operators. So it's a subgroup of some unitary group of a Hilbert space. So first, say if we assume that dimension of G is finite, then you know from linear algebra that you can diagonalize unitary matrices. So what you get is that this unitary group can be written in diagonal form as follows. So it's going to be sum, say, I from 1 to L, into the power I, t times pi, where pi's are orthogonal projections. Projections with some of those projections equal to identity. So it's really just another way of saying that unitary matrices can be diagonalized over. So here, as I's are some real numbers which correspond to the eigenvalues of these unitary matrices. So now, in our staging, we are forced to work with infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces. And so it's no longer true that there are any eigenvalues. So maybe it would be convenient to think about an example of a unitary one-parameter group. So say you can consider operators U sub t from L2 of R to L2 of R, which map function f to function e to the power tx of x. So that's one of the possible examples of a unitary group of operators. And here there are no eigenvalues, but still the picture looks very similar. And so indeed there is a general theory which allows, so there is a natural substitute for this statement, which is, so it turns out that there is there is a projection projection valued measure on on R. So what I mean is going to be a map P from Borel subsets R to the set of projections in H, orthogonal projections in H.
In your example, G is R.
So here. So far I'm just talking about one parameter groups. Yes.
No, I mean L2 of G. You wrote e to the itx f of x. So mm-hmm. x is where x is.
So x is the variable of the function. So that's a new function, right?
So x is in the group G.
L2. Yes, sorry, thanks. Yeah, so it's really just L2 of R. Essentially typical example of what happens, and the general theory tells us that there is a projection valued measure. So it's a map from Borel subsets of R to projections in projections on the Hilbert space H, which is so it satisfies the usual properties of measures. So it's say sigma additive and P of R is equal to the identity map, and so in fact this projection valued measure is so it's a projection valued measure on R, so let me be emphasize that it's associated to this one parameter group. With the property that this one parameter group can be written as an integral so yeah, it looks quite abstract if you haven't seen it before, but one can develop the same theory of integration as for instead of functions with values in R, you can also consider functions with values in a Gilbert space, and then develop a theory of integration. So it's really, if you like, you can think about this formally, but it's something that can be done. You can check it in the functional analysis course. Okay, so now let's use this very very important tool in our proof. So what I'm going to do in the proof, I'm going to consider the following subgroup of SLN, which is a semi-direct product of SL to R times R2, so which is, in other words, can be written as these matrices. And they are embedded in, there are many obvious embeddings inside the SLN R. So let's fix this group sitting inside SLNR. So I denote this by G, and this I denote by A. Okay, let's try to understand. So maybe first of all, so here A is a abelian group. So for a abelian group, we can apply. So I wrote it for one parameter actions, but if it's two parameter abelian action, it's still the same discussion applies as well. So using the spectral theory, we know that rho of A can be written as an integral here is going to be a projection value measure in R2, because we have two parameters. Right? So I can write it in this form. Somehow it's very important that this group is not abelian. So there is a certain relation when you conjugate R2 by the group G. So we have the following. So if I have, say, I have G in G and A in A, then I have the following commutation relation. So G inverse A G. So if you do the computation, right? So you have G so then you get identity G inverse A. So this is the same as rho of G inverse applied to A. So now it's an element in A. So on one side I can write this operator as e to the i s Like this, and I can also move G to the other side of this color product. So this becomes. Inverse transpose. Yes. A. G. X. So that's one way of writing this operator, but on the other hand, this operator is also it can be written as a conjugation of rho of A. So then I can rewrite it as an integral over R2 of S A. And here I'm applying conjugation, so it's the same as just conjugating this projection valued measure. So it's integral with respect to rho G inverse P of S rho of G. Okay, and so I have two different ways of writing the same operator, and it's part of the theory of this spectral valued measure, so that the spectral measure is unique. So in fact, this property here implies a corresponding property for the measure P of S. So what I'm getting is that the measure P of S should satisfy the following. So if I take push forward of this measure, so it's G transpose U. So this should be the same as S. This should be the same as the conjugation.
S and U.
Oh, sorry, S. Yes. So maybe it's a good place to stop. So I think I should say a little bit more. Yeah. So maybe next time I'm going to start with this identity and show how it would imply that. So maybe I just say the idea that somehow using that we are going to construct invariant measures on. On the projective, so two invariant measure on the projective line, which would give a contradiction. So that's somehow the basic idea, but still there is some steps to complete here. So any questions about what I said so far? Yes?
The exercise.
Ah, okay. Yeah. So there are exercises, but yeah, any questions about lectures? Or? Okay, so if there are no questions, then...